Children, let us continue the lesson, Microorganisms, Friend and Foe. We have already studied about the beneficial microorganisms. Let us come to harmful microorganisms. Harmful in the sense, some microorganisms are there which causes diseases in plants and animals. Not only plants and animals, they cause diseases in human beings also. So such disease causing microorganisms are called as pathogens. So let us study more about their harmful activities also. So disease causing microorganisms in humans, how they cause diseases in humans, what are the diseases caused? Let us study in detail. Now we have to know about communicable diseases. You all know that pathogens. What are pathogens? Pathogens means the microbes which causes diseases are known as pathogens. These pathogens enter our body through the air we breathe or the water we drink or the food we eat. They can also get transmitted by direct contact with an infected person or carried by an animal. So microbial diseases that can spread from an infected person to a healthy person through air, water, food or physical contact are called as communicable diseases. What are communicable diseases? The disease that can spread from the infected person to a healthy person by means of air, water, food or direct contact with the infected person are known as communicable diseases. We have the examples such as cholera, common cold, chickenpox and tuberculosis for communicable diseases. Children, whenever you suffer from cold, you sneeze, isn't it? So what may happen? Fine droplets of moisture carrying thousands of viruses spread in the air. The viruses may enter the body of a healthy person while breathing and cause infection in them. What can we do in order to control the spread of diseases during cold? So we have to close our mouth with a handkerchief or a hanky while sneezing. It is better to keep distance from the infected persons also. There are some insects and animals which acts as carriers of disease causing microbes. These carriers such as insects and animals carry pathogens in them. For example, you all know about housefly. It is also one such carrier. The flies sit on the garbage and animal excreta. Pathogens stick to their bodies. When these flies sit on uncovered food, they may transfer the pathogens into the food. So whoever eats the contaminated food is likely to get the illness. What can we do? We have to close the food. Always we have to keep the food covered. Avoid consuming uncovered items of food. We must not eat the food which is uncovered. Another example of a carrier is the female Anopheles mosquito. This mosquito, female Anopheles mosquito, carries the parasite called Plasmodium, which spreads malaria in human beings. So one more carrier is female Aedes mosquito, which acts as a carrier of dengue virus. Children, you might have heard people saying that water must not get collected anywhere or it must not get stagnant. Why is that? Because mosquitoes breed in water. Hence, one should not let water collect anywhere. It may be in coolers, tires, or flower pots. By keeping the surroundings clean and dry, we can prevent mosquitoes from breeding. We have to keep our environment clean. Then only we will be away from diseases. We can keep ourselves away from diseases by keeping ourselves clean and also keeping our environment clean. Let us study some of the common human diseases caused by microorganisms. Tuberculosis is a disease caused by bacteria which is transmitted through air, and the preventive measures are keeping the patient in complete isolation, and we have to keep the personal belongings of the patient away from those of the others. Vaccination also can be given at the suitable age. The same preventive measures will hold good for these three diseases also, that is measles, chickenpox and polio, which is caused by virus and transmitted through air, water or direct contact. Coming to cholera and typhoid, these diseases are caused by the microorganism bacteria. At the same time, the mode of transmission for these diseases are water and food. What are the preventive measures? Maintain personal hygiene and good sanitary habits. Always one has to keep himself clean. At the same time, after using the washroom, he has to wash his hands and feet properly. And he has to consume cooked food and drink boiled drinking water. Vaccination can also prevent these diseases. Next is hepatitis A, which is caused by bacteria, and the mode of transmission is water. How can we prevent these hepatitis A? That is by drinking boiled water. At the same time, vaccination also can prevent this. Next is malaria, as we have already studied just now, which is caused by the protozoan, and mosquito is the carrier. Female Anopheles mosquito is the carrier of this protozoan. What are the preventive measures? We have to use mosquito net and repellents that keep the mosquitoes away. At the same time, spraying insecticides and controlling the breeding of mosquitoes must be taken care. That means water must not get collected here and there in the surroundings. Water must not get stagnant. We have to keep our surroundings clean. Microorganisms not only cause diseases in humans and plants, but also they cause diseases in animals. For example, anthrax is a dangerous human and cattle disease caused by bacterium. Foot and mouth disease of cattle is caused by virus. There are several microorganisms which cause diseases in plants like wheat, rice, potato, sugarcane, orange and so on. What may be the result? You might have seen the plants, sometimes they decay or they die, or you can see the spoiling of the leaves, or you can see spots in the leaves and fruits or in the vegetables. All these are the diseases in plants caused by microorganisms. Some of the diseases are citrus canker, that is caused by the microorganism bacteria. Rust of wheat is caused by fungus, and yellow vein mosaic disease caused by virus. So there are many plant diseases. At the same time, how can we control them? Of course, use of certain chemicals can be made use of in order to control these microbes. Can the food we eat become a poison? Sometimes it happens so. Food poisoning could be due to the consumption of food spoiled by some microorganisms. Microorganisms grow in our food and produce toxic substances or poisonous substances. These poisonous food substances cause serious illness in human beings and it may lead to death also sometimes. So it is very important that we preserve the food to keep it away from being spoiled. You all know that spoiled food emits bad smell and has a bad taste, and sometimes it changes its color also. You might have brought fruit and vegetables in rainy season. What may happen after a few days? It gets spoiled or rotten. But you all have pickles at home. Pickles, of course, mango pickle or lemon pickle can be preserved for years without getting spoiled, and you can taste it also. You can eat it properly without any infection being caused in your stomach, isn't it? So food items can be preserved also with some effective measures. Let us study the common methods of preserving food in our homes. First one is chemical method. Salts and edible oil are the common chemicals used to check the growth of microorganisms. They are known as preservatives. We add salt or acid preservatives to pickles to prevent the attack of microbes. Some more chemicals are sodium benzoate and sodium metabisulfite. They are also used in jams and squashes in order to check their spoilage. The next method is by using common salt. Common salt is also known as sodium chloride or NaCl. It is used to preserve meat and fish for ages. Meat and fish are covered with dry salt to check the growth of bacteria. Salting method is also used to preserve raw mangoes, tamarind, and other food items. Next is preservation by sugar. Jams, jellies, and squashes are preserved by using sugar. Why? Because it reduces the moisture content, which prevents the growth of bacteria. Preservation by oil and vinegar. Use of oil and vinegar prevents spoilage of pickles because bacteria cannot live in such an environment. Vegetables, fruits, fish and meat are also often preserved by using oil and vinegar. Heat and cold treatment. Boiling kills many microorganisms. At the same time, we can keep our food in the refrigerator where there is low temperature. Low temperature prevents the growth of microbes. So, heat and cold treatment is also one of the best methods. One more method is storage and packing. Whenever we pack the fruits or vegetables, it is packed in airtight containers or airtight packets to prevent the attack of microbes. More method of preserving food item is pasteurization. Here, the milk is heated to about 70 degrees Celsius for 15 to 30 seconds and then suddenly chilled and stored. What may happen if we do so? It prevents the growth of microbes. This method was discovered for the first time by Louis Pasteur. Understood the process of pasteurization? The treatment of milk where the milk is heated to about 70 degrees Celsius. And it is suddenly chilled and stored. Let us study about nitrogen fixation. You all know that our atmosphere has 78% of nitrogen gas. This nitrogen is fixed by one of the bacterium known as rhizobium, which you have studied in your smaller classes only. This rhizobium bacteria lives in the root nodules of leguminous plants such as beans and peas. And it shows a symbiotic relationship. What is symbiotic relationship? A relationship where both the organisms live together and both the organisms are benefited from each other. There is interdependence or mutual interdependence between the organisms. This rhizobium lives in the root nodules of the leguminous plants. They get the shelter from the plants. At the same time, these rhizobium bacteria fixes the atmospheric nitrogen in the soil. Thereby, both rhizobium bacteria at the same time, even the plants are benefited from each other. So, you all know that some of the nitrogen from the atmosphere also gets converted into its smaller forms by lightning during the lightning process. Even then, the amount of nitrogen in the atmosphere remains constant. Let us study in detail about the nitrogen cycle. As I explained already, our atmosphere has 78% of nitrogen gas. And nitrogen is one of the essential constituents of all living organisms. It is in the form of proteins, chlorophyll, nucleic acid, and vitamins also. The atmospheric nitrogen cannot be taken directly by plants and animals. It has to be converted into its smaller forms. So, rhizobium bacteria and blue-green algae present in the soil fix nitrogen from the atmosphere and convert it into compounds of nitrogen. Once nitrogen is converted into these usable compounds, then it can be used by the plants from the soil. You all know that nitrogen is then used for the synthesis of plant proteins and other compounds. Animals always feed on plants. Henceforth, they get the proteins indirectly from the plants. And other nitrogenous compounds also enter the body of animals. When plants and animals die, bacteria and fungi present in the soil convert the nitrogenous waste into nitrogenous compounds, which can be used by plants again. And there are many bacteria in the soil also which can convert the nitrogenous compounds into gaseous nitrogen and send back to the atmosphere. As a result, the percentage of nitrogen in the atmosphere remains more or less constant. It remains as 78% only. Once again, to explain about nitrogen cycle, this is the atmospheric nitrogen. It is converted into compounds of nitrogen in the soil. It may be by the bacteria or during lightning also, or it may be by the blue-green algae also. This compounds of nitrogen is used by the plants. Hence, the plants can utilize the nitrogen from the soil. At the same time, animals eat the plants, and the nitrogenous waste from the excretion and death of plants and animals will join the soil. Again, some bacteria are there which lives in the soil, which converts the nitrogenous compounds back into gaseous nitrogen. These gaseous nitrogen join the atmosphere once again. So, there is rotation of nitrogen from one form to another in a cyclic movement, and this is known as nitrogen cycle.